Okay, we are back with Salenas, and we were just talking about, so we're going to segue past Miss Tanya Toll and Beyond
please
Shelter.
Don't, please do.
Because you basically just said, God bless you, thank you very
left
much.
It. Left,
left
it.
It. Yes. Left it. Okay. Then, what's interesting to me is, though, even though we both dealt with homelessness, you dealt with so much more, a different side of it than I did, just like Renata and Alex did, because they had families. And so many people think that there are all these outstanding services for single women and children and families and services.
And it's not.
And it's not. Now, you were just telling me that after there, you had to leave the West Side to go down to the
Skid Row. Yes.
For services. What was your experience with services down there?
Oh, first they talked to me real kind, and once they got my information, one of the workers tried to call the police on me because I wouldn't accept his help. Mm-hmm. And then he said, well, since you have children, one child at least that's a minor, he said, I'm going to call Children's Services. And he called Children's Services, and they were like, we can't take her daughter from her. You know, she's an honor student. It'd be different if she was bad or on drugs or mm-hmm. anything. So he actually offered me help, but then he got mad because I wouldn't accept his help in the manner that he wanted to separate me from my family.
And you didn't want your family separated.
I didn't want them separated because my son was in college. My daughter, Crystal, she was in school full-time. And Keisha was in school full-time.
And it wasn't like your kids were like 22, 33 years old. These were kids just starting
teenagers.
Out.
Teenagers, yeah.
Just
teenagers.
Starting out.
They were teenagers.
So most mothers still want to protect their kids and be with their kids.
Exactly.
And most children are still ready to stay with their parents.
Exactly.
I know I was.
Well, see, my mother and father's passed away, and they don't have any relationships with their grandparents
mm-hmm.
or their aunts and uncles or even my sister. I have a sister and a brother, and I asked my sister, could we sleep on her floor? And she said no, but she smokes drugs and she sells drugs. So mm-hmm. I didn't want my kids under that environment.
Mm-hmm.
So we had no other alternative but to be in the streets and be homeless. And it, you know, it wasn't by choice, but I still had to be, it's weird because I still had to be a mother. I still had to take my daughter for checkups mm-hmm. at the doctor. She still had to go get, see the dentist.
Mm-hmm.
She still had to do just the regular things.
And homework.
Life.
She still had to do homework. That homework in order to be an A student.
Every day.
What was that like for you as a parent, knowing that you're doing the best that you can for your kids? Did it make you feel like, you know what, I'm not doing all I can? How did it make you feel as a single mom?
I felt lost, for one. There was times when I did like get to myself and just cry and pray and say, God, please help me because I don't have any help and I don't know where to go because it seemed like every time I go somewhere to get assistance, it was always a problem. It was always, well, this even with getting in shelters, I called InfoLine and they said, well, we can help you, but we can't. You know, they wanted to separate us.
Right.
We can help just you and the little one. And then, this one is too young. This one is too old. You know, it was always something with the system. And I said, so what do you do if you're in that box? And then with my situation, I had Section 8. When I moved, my Section 8 expired. You have 90 days to relocate. And after my owner opted the property out of Section 8, that 90 days expired. I had lost my Section 8.
Mm-hmm.
So then St. Joseph's Center, they helped me get it back. But they said I was under stress and I couldn't keep up with my appointments. So they conditioned it. They said, okay, well, now we're going to get your Section 8 back, but you can only stay in the city of Santa Monica. And I actually got my Section 8 through FEMA.
Mm-hmm.
We owned a house back in 97, and we lost it in an earthquake.
Mm-hmm.
And they condemned the house. We lost it completely. So FEMA, the government, came out and gave us Section 8. And that's
mm-hmm.
how I ended up with Section 8. I was never on the list. You know, the government gave it to us because me and my kids, we lost our house.
Mm-hmm.
And then to see that even now be broken down to, you know, St. Joseph's Center having the authority over where I can live and where I can move. I can't port anywhere. And, you know, and then with Santa Monica, at that particular time that I was homeless, I had a $600 utility bill
mm-hmm.
on my name. From, you know, having to move all of a sudden, and I couldn't get in a place. So it's like when I did apply and put in applications and see managers, once they ran the credit check, they were like, oh, well, you owe utilities, you can't move in. I was turned away, I say, at least about maybe 16, 17 homes. Just because of credit, even community corporations. Just.
And then how are you able to save money when you're paying for things like sleeping on a bus, when you're paying for eating out every night, when you're
There's no way to save.
There's absolutely there's no way to save. Because what you take in is going right back out.
Right back out, immediately. And some people don't understand that. It's like, it now in this society, even a motel or hotel that's even not halfway decent, it's almost $100 a day.
Right.
You can't pay $100 a day, have to eat, and then have other things. Like, I have two females, so we have hygiene things we have to get. All that costs money. And it's like, and then I had a storage that was almost $100 every month. So that had to be dished out, or we would lose the things that we did have. Mm-hmm. And it was crazy. It was a crazy way to live. I wouldn't wish that on my worst enemy, but I'm thankful that I was able to go through it with a positive attitude. Mm-hmm. And I know what we did is we got blessed with some portable DVD players, and we would watch comedy movies. Mm-hmm. So we would sit up and laugh, watching Jerry Lewis, Dean Martin, the Three Stooges, you know, and Keisha had all her little videotapes, you know, that she would watch animated stuff because she liked anime, Japanese movies. And I think that encouraged us to keep going, keep it moving. Because, like I said, sometimes we didn't have money. We would sleep at the bus stop. Mm-hmm. We would ride the buses all night long. And that was a whole different world within itself, because you get people 1, 2, 3 o'clock in the morning that are insanely crazy. The ones that really are mentally ill, and they don't want to get help, and they don't want to get off the streets. And this is the way they want to, they choose to live. Mm-hmm.
And then you find yourself having to deal with them.
Yeah.
Police
officers
and bus drivers that don't want to stop
with attitudes.
Bus.
Not only that, when you go to, when too many people are on the bus, 2 o'clock in the morning, they sleep. The bus driver will drive erratically just to wake people up.
Just to wake people up. Yeah. Or turn the air.
Or turn the air conditioner on where it's freezing cold.
And it's pouring down rain outside.
Yeah. 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 And I mean, some of them just rude. They just talk so rude to the people where, you know, I'm like, oh, wow.
That's... Why do you have to talk to us like that?
Yeah.
What did we do? Didn't we just pay our fare to get on this bus?
Yeah. It's ridiculous.
One thing that for me that sticks out with you, and something that's just refreshing for me, is your faith. Because I was told many times, if you just turn that voice off in your head. And I was like, no, if I turn that voice off in my head.
Don't want to ever do that.
I don't ever want to turn that voice off.
Ever
I know
do that.
For me, it was my faith that got me through the times when I felt like giving up. When I felt like, God, this is just too much.
Well, see, I think my breaking point, my blessing point, I can't say breaking point. Because, it did humble my spirit more than it already was. Because I'm like, I'm dying in Jesus' name. So it's like, you know, it's like, devil, why are you even bothering me? You're wasting your time. Mm-hmm. but because of the things I've lived through and seen, that I know God is real, you know, beyond religion and any kind of other beliefs. But my kids got separated.
Right.
You know, where my son was in Palmdale. Mm-hmm. My daughter was in Compton. Mm-hmm. And then my youngest daughter was with Children's Services. Mm-hmm. I had a friend that we befriended, a counselor at Santa Monica High, who actually tried to hook us up with an apartment. Mm-hmm. And we found out that it didn't work out because of my credit record. Mm-hmm. And she got upset. So she called Children's Services thinking that she was doing something good. And they took my daughter from me. That alone was devastating. I was like, oh my God. But then I said, I can continue on. Because it would be just like if I was single and didn't have any kids at all, you know, I could start over on my own. But see, I still knew I had to fight that fight to get my family back together. Mm-hmm. You know, I was like, it was bad enough. Their father left and wasn't around in the picture to help at all. So I was like, I think I was sleeping in the bathroom in Santa Monica and at the pier. Mm-hmm. And I found, and in this bathroom stall, you know, where I put paper down or whatever, was sitting there and just sitting up about to go to sleep. And I was like, God, please help me. And I said, I can't do this. I can't go through this anymore. My family is separated. And, you know, God is number one. My family is number two. And we need to be together because my kids encouraged me. Mom, it's going to be okay. And God had blessed us. My son had texted me and told me, Mom, meet me. And I was like, meet you where? He was like, meet me at the room. I'm like, what room? He said, the Marigo. And I was like, what is a Marigo? So, you know, I'm familiar with a lot of different motels, but I was like, who is a Marigo? He was like, Marriott. And I was like, what?
When we come back, we're going to talk to Salenas and how she got through this.